Hi, my name is Judie VanKooiman, and you're watching Life Issues. This month's show is on ADHD, and my guests are Drew Coman and Jennifer Kravitz. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
My pleasure. Drew, I'm going to start with you. What is your title?
So I'm an assistant in psychology or staff psychologist at Massachusetts General Hospital, an instructor at Harvard Medical School, and also the founder of Coman Psychological Educational and Assessment Group.
Wow, you wear many hats.
Many hats, yeah.
That's good.
Many fun hats, yeah.
That's good. That's very interesting. And how long have you been a psychologist?
So I've been working with children, adolescents, young adults for about 13 years in some aspects of either therapy, assessment, or research. And I've been a licensed psychologist for 3 years now.
Okay, good. And what does ADHD stand for?
So ADHD stands for Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder.
Okay, so abbreviate ADHD
because
it's
ADHD
a lot easier to say.
Yes. Yeah.
And what are the different types?
So there are primarily three different types. One of the types is a hyperactive or impulsive type. So primarily with that type, we generally see hyperactivity, impulsivity, or difficulties kind of exhibiting forethought with your behaviors. There's also a predominantly inattentive type. With that particular type of ADHD, typically what we see are individuals with vulnerabilities that are just specific to attention distractibility. And then there's a combined presentation where individuals exhibit kind of vulnerabilities associated with both hyperactivity or restlessness at times, impulse control, in addition to the attentional weaknesses.
Okay, great, thank you. And Jennifer, I'm gonna switch over to you. Your oldest son has ADHD, and how old was Dylan when he was diagnosed with it?
Dylan was diagnosed in kindergarten at the age of 5 and a half.
And how old is he now?
He is 7.
And how is he doing?
Dylan is, he's a handful, but he's doing wonderful. He really is doing good with school services and everything. I would say he's doing great.
Yeah. I will add that I know Dylan personally, mm-hmm. and I have seen a change in him since he was mm-hmm. diagnosed and everything, so he's more engaging now.
Absolutely.
When I walk into the house, he'll mm-hmm. actually say hi to me, usually,
yeah.
and stuff.
But, absolutely.
But he's fun to be with and mm-hmm. stuff, yeah. Very smart.
Thank you.
And what is an IEP?
An IEP is a individualized education plan. So it is basically student to student. Different students with different issues, disabilities, require different things. So it comes with the individualized, and it is
a lot of supports, right?
From
the school. It's a good contract with
absolutely
with the school district that provides a lot of supports in allowing probably Dylan to optimize his strengths, but
absolutely.
Also support some of his vulnerabilities,
absolutely.
Either within or kind of outside the classroom or school community.
Correct. So, and what are different things that he does in school to help with his ADHD?
Dylan is in a inclusion classroom. So it is basically 50-50 with general ed kids and children who are on IEPs. So that has been a huge helping in his education and at home. So now he receives all of his services inside the inclusion classroom. So he gets one-on-one for reading. He gets small groups for math. He gets pulled out of class 4 times a week for OT, which is occupational therapy. And that's the only time that he gets pulled out of class now, which is much different from last year or the year before, where he was getting pulled out 3-4 times. Mm. So since being in the inclusion classroom, I've definitely seen a huge improvement with him. He's come a long way in the last year. He also gets, the preferential seating. So he sits up front, or sits in the middle of the class where the teacher can always, keep an eye on him. He sits next to a role model student, which I think is great. He knows that he can go to that person for help. It's kind of like a buddy system. So that's been really cool because he comes home and he's like, Mom, you know, this person taught me how to do this, or Mom, this person taught me how to do that. So as a mother, that's amazing to see.
Yeah.
And as he gets older, he'll get more things as like the MCAS comes, you know, timed, not timed tests and stuff like that. So for right now, it's basically preferential seating, all of his services in class. He gets fidget tools and things like that.
To step back a little bit, back to the IEP. Mm-hmm. Now, Dylan isn't just thrown into a classroom. There's a group of people, teachers, staff, et cetera, that meet with you as a parent?
Yes.
During the school year?
Yep. So we have 2 IEP meetings a year. Our IEP meeting is coming up in December. And then we have one at the end of the school year. So I believe it's every 6 months. Mm-hmm. And the first IEP meeting basically, you know, goes over how he's doing, what needs to be improved, if more goals need to be met, if they're not being met, what can we do to fix them? You know, just little simple things like last year's IEP meeting, we added, Dylan uses a weighted lap pad, and it's basically a little piece of fabric that has weights in it, and it helps him focus better in school. So that was personally added into his IEP. So yeah, we all meet as a little, you know, support team. System and team, and he has 3 teachers in his class, and he also has an OT teacher. And then, you know, us as a family, we all just meet together and work together to help Dylan strive.
It's important for a child to have that big support.
Absolutely.
Yeah, very important. Okay, and Drew, what are some of the symptoms of ADHD?
Some of the primary symptoms in the different subtypes kind of allude to them. But primarily what we see is difficulties with attention. Difficulties with sustained attention, or let's say attention to details, or maybe challenges with kind of making careless mistakes, things of that nature. We also see vulnerabilities with hyperactivity or restlessness, and also impulse control. So impulse control or impulsivity is just really difficulties with kind of thinking about your behaviors before you engage in a behavior. So that's really kind of what impulse control is. We also see challenges with organization at times, planning, following multi-step directions, difficulties with distractibility within the classroom setting or other settings. So if there's a lot of extraneous noise or things like that, children with vulnerabilities associated with ADHD can be prone to be more distractible in those types of environments. And what also comes with ADHD sometimes are social challenges, and in addition to sometimes difficulties regulating emotions. So that all kind of falls within falls under that umbrella of ADHD. Those are all skill sets that are really called executive functions. And it's governed by the frontal lobes of our brain. It helps us do a lot of different things, including all of those, or managing all of those. To a degree, so.
Okay, and what is the process of a child being diagnosed?
Yep, I think there's different processes. I think families go through many different processes. I think one of the most common processes that families go through are having discussions with their pediatrician. You know, I would recommend that to families if there are concerns, either family concerns or school concerns, teacher concerns, then, you know, I would recommend a family first discuss that with their pediatrician. Really have long discussions with your pediatrician about your concerns and getting kind of an objective professional opinion about whether these are falling outside of what we'd expect for that child's particular age. And then in that discussion, what you would also converse about is this, would seeing a specialty provider be indicated, such as a psychologist like myself, a pediatric neurologist, child psychiatrist, or developmental pediatrician, someone with, those are kind of professionals with specialty training in making a comprehensive evaluation. So, and then if that is decided that a specialty provider would be indicated, typically what will, should be completed is a comprehensive clinical evaluation, which includes collecting information, medical history, developmental history, as well as multi-informant reporting. So we want to get information from mom, from dad, from school is always helpful, because one of the primary, let's say one of the primary criteria of ADHD is that we're seeing those vulnerabilities that we talked about across multiple settings, at least two settings. So we want to get information from both settings. And then oftentimes one of the best kind of ways to get an evaluation is to get a comprehensive neuropsychological evaluation. And that way what you're doing is you're really getting a comprehensive profile of a particular child or individual's strengths and weaknesses from a cognitive standpoint, from an academic standpoint, social, emotional, behavioral, attention, memory, and so forth. So, okay,
great. And what is the treatment?
So I think treatment is, there are multiple treatments. I think primarily what we are, what we typically do in terms of treatment planning is a comprehensive assessment needs to inform the treatment. So the comprehensive assessment should really kind of inform and dictate what treatment would be indicated for that particular child, because treatments can be different based on that child's profile, strengths and weaknesses, differences in environment, and so forth. One of the primary treatments is behavioral therapy. So behavioral therapy can comprise cognitive behavioral therapy, which helps children kind of think about what they're thinking about or thinking about their behaviors. Also, behavioral therapy utilizing things such as reward systems and token economies. There's some really great programs that can be found online. One is called the Daily Report Card, which parents can utilize at home, and within the school can utilize that within the school setting. In addition to the behavioral therapy services, for some children, medication management can be extremely helpful. It can allow them to can be helpful in the home, for the home and the school setting. It also can be helpful in concert with the behavioral therapy services and allow them to access some of those treatments much better.
Mm-hmm. Great. And what is the prevention of ADHD?
Yeah, the prevention of ADHD, I think that's a really interesting question. I think we know that ADHD, that genes play a role, that there's a high level of what we call heritability in ADHD. However, our genes are not our destiny, right? We know that genes play a role, but we really think about all conditions from what we call a biopsychosocial model. That means that we know that likely that there's some biological things that are coming into play, but there's also probably some other things like environmental things that can come into play as well. And so in terms of preventing ADHD, we know that genetics play a role, but we also know that there are some probably environmental things that come into play. And really what we would recommend is, as kind of what you would think, is just really kind of a healthy peri and prenatal environment. In addition to that, there are certain things that we would like to avoid in terms of a child's early development, right? So what we want are to engender what we call protective factors, things like reading to your child, having them engage in kind of specialized time where there's not a lot of distractibility going on, putting down the cell phone and having family dinners. All of those things can serve as really good protective factors and support kind of healthy brain development to, let's say, prevent a vulnerabilities associated with ADHD. There's nothing that parents do by any means that cause ADHD, but we know that there's things that we can do as parents that can serve as good protective factors if there's a particular child with a genetic predisposition towards the condition.
Okay. And Jennifer, do you have any advice for other parents that are going through what you went through with Dylan?
just be your child's biggest advocate. My issue was is that I listened to a lot of other people. I listened to a lot of other, teachers, daycare providers, that just told me, you know, nothing's wrong with him. Nothing's wrong with Dylan. He's perfect. And by all means, he is. He's perfect in my eyes. But I always knew there was just that little, you know, something wrong, something out of place. And they, you know, everyone used to tell me it's his age. He's a boy. Mm-hmm. It's his age. I never stopped believing. I never stopped advocating for my son. I got things done quickly. I'm proud of it. Dylan went through evaluations in school. Dylan had a full neuropsych eval done. Dylan was on a full IEP, all within a 6-month period. I never stopped. I never stopped advocating for my son. And to this day, I never stop advocating. I'll never stop advocating for my kids. So that is my biggest, you know, that's my biggest thing is just believe in your child. You know, don't ever give up and go with your gut.
Good. Very good. Now, True, can adults get ADHD or do they have ADHD too?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, as with anything, things look different with age, right? So the vulnerabilities, let's say, that a particular individual exhibits that's associated with ADHD is going to look much different at age, let's say 5 or 6, and age 10 or 11, and into the teens, and then young adulthood and adulthood. So, you know, in adulthood, we oftentimes don't see the significant levels of hyperactivity, adults climbing on furniture or adults doing those things, because what happens is that the frontal lobes of your brain continue to develop, and that helps us humans to control some of those restlessness or behaviors or hyperactivity. Now, adults with ADHD may be somewhat fidgety. They may have difficulties with impulse control at times, or may have difficulties with attention as well. One of the primary things one of the common things that we see are what we call executive functioning weaknesses in adults, right? So difficulties with time management, organization, making sure you have all the materials that you need before you head out to work in the morning, things of that nature. Mm.
Okay, very interesting. Thank you. And is there anything else that you would like to share with our audience about ADHD or anything that they should know about?
Well, I think Jennifer made a really great point about advocating for your child mm-hmm. is the best thing that you can do. And really the early identification and early intervention, I think that goes back to your question, Judy, about prevention. That is one of, you know, that is probably the foremost important thing, is that if you have concerns, talk with someone, talk with your pediatrician, talk with the school psychologist, and reach out to providers. That's just a really fantastic thing to do.
Okay. And Drew, if anyone would like more information, can you please give us your website?
Sure, I have a website. It's www.drewcoman.com, so drewcoman. They can feel free, there's some information on there, and they can feel free to go to that website.
Okay, great, thank you. And Jennifer, would you like to give a contact for yourself if anyone has any questions for you?
Sure, my email address is jwilliams, so jwillims, 81205@yahoo.com.
Okay, great. I'm sorry, but that's all the time that we have. Thank you for helping all those who need help. And thank you, Jennifer, for being a great parent and helping your son manage this.
No problem.
I'd love to hear your thoughts and suggestions. Please send them to lifeissuestv@gmail.com. And remember, live each day to the fullest and celebrate life.
It's hard to care.